lovely to see so many people with us. I would like to introduce our Minister Neil, if nobody or newcomers to the church has never met me. Welcome in. And I have just a few notices. The charity Christmas card sale next week. We would like to have some more volunteers to actually help with serving teas and coffees, but we would also like to have some more help with making cakes. So if you could let Sue and David know if you're available to bring some cakes, that would be lovely. Sue would like to say a word.
I'll stay here because I can shout.
Okay.
Just to let you know, although it will be on the storyboard next week, but in case anybody's not here, anybody that remembers Carol Leach, who went to Scotland 25 years ago, she will be at Coffee Pot a week on Tuesday, that's the 16th. So you're very welcome to come in and pop in and say hello.
Can I just say we have just a few minutes silence before Neil starts our worship.
Caroline, for your words of introduction and welcome this morning. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
It's great to be with you on this 25th Sunday in our season of Pentecost. We meet as family in the presence of our Heavenly Father. We meet as brothers and sisters together in Christ, accepting the responsibility that this places upon us to love one another as God has loved us. We meet as God's light in this dark world and pray that through our words and our lives, others might be drawn into God's family and accept him as their Lord and Saviour. Psalm 127 is a song for pilgrims ascending to Jerusalem, a Psalm of Solomon, which says, "Unless the Lord builds a house, the work of the builders is wasted. Unless the Lord protects a city, guarding it with sentries will do it no good. It is useless for you to work so hard from early morning until late at night, anxiously working for food to eat, for God gives rest to his loved ones." Our opening hymn this morning is number 560 from Mission Praise. "Praise my soul, the King of Heaven, to his feet by tribute bring, ransomed, healed, restored, forgiven, who like thee his praise should sing." And like we had a couple of weeks ago in church, this hymn is actually from just an instrumental version of this hymn. It's an actual led version, so we sing along to this hymn number 560.
Thank you.
our time of worship, let us come before God in our prayers. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, when we walk with you in the light of your love, it is your glory seen, not ours. Heavenly Father, when we talk of you to those whom we meet, it is your words that speak, not ours. Heavenly Father, when we minister to people in need, it is your hands that heal, not ours. Heavenly Father, when we worship you and offer you our lives, your name is glorified always. For the Lord is our salvation, the rock upon which we stand, the light by which we walk, the strength by which we overcome. Therefore we shall live by faith and fear no one, for the Lord our God is with us, walking beside and before us, sheltering us from harm. So today it is the Lord's song that we sing, God's praises within our hearts, God's words upon our lips, and the reason that we live and worship our God. Heavenly Father, we confess that God is love and that we are God's children. There is no fear in love, and we love because you first loved us. We confess to you that we have sinned in thought, word, and action. We are truly sorry, and we ask for your forgiveness. Deliver us from the power of evil for the sake of your Son, who through his death and resurrection we have been raised to new life. Here and now, in this time and in this place, we ask you to transform our lives and teach us how to walk in your way. We ask these prayers in the name of Jesus Christ, who is our Lord and Saviour, and who taught us when we pray to share together his disciples' prayer, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptations, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Our Gospel reading this morning comes from Mark chapter 12, reading verses 38 to 44. Jesus continued teaching. Watch out for the religion scholars. They love to walk around in academic gowns, preening in the radiance of public flattery, basking in prominent positions, sitting at the head table of every church function. And all the time they are exploiting the weak and helpless. The longer their prayers, the worse they get. But they'll pay for it in the end. Sitting across from the offering box, Jesus was observing how the crowd put money in for the collection. Many of the rich were making large contributions. One poor widow came up and put in two small coins. Jesus called his disciples over and said, The truth is that this poor widow gave more to the collection than all the others put together. All the others gave what they'll never miss. But she gave extravagantly what she couldn't afford. She gave her all. It's so good to see so many of you here this morning. You've come on an opportune Sunday, for we are meeting this morning not just as our church, but as family church, when our children will be going up to our upstairs room for their own activities and lesson this morning. So it's an opportunity for them to partake in their own Sunday church. But that, of course, is that this is only the second time that we've done this in the last 18 months. It's been such a difficult time that we've had difficulty making provision for our children to come and learn and worship with us. But hopefully this will be the start. We're also doing this again on the first Sunday in December as well, so we should be sharing in this way. But my question to the children this morning, and I know I can only ask this to a few of the children who are here this morning, so I was hoping that somebody like Esther or Florey would give me the answer to this. What is the difference between today and, let's say, 18 months ago when you were last in church, say, you know, somewhere around February the 20th, 2020, something like that. What do you think the difference between today and then is, Esther? When we could come to church. What do you think the difference was?
You went upstairs quite early on.
You did go upstairs quite early on. That's not the difference I'm thinking of. There's another difference today. Were you putting your hand up, Evie, were you?
The chair
cushions have
changed
there now. Yeah, that wasn't the one I was actually thinking of, yes? I'm thinking just before people started to wear face masks. Esther, you're having another go, are you? What do you think the difference is? Getting birthday cards, that's true. Well, hopefully we get those birthday cards delivered. Is that true, Jenny? Yeah, she's nodding her head. Yes, it's what do you think?
Social distancing.
Social distancing, yeah, well, just before social distancing came in. What I'm thinking about, go on ahead to me.
Happy birthday washing your hands day.
Happy birthday washing hands day, no, not happy birthday washing your hands day. Esther.
When you went up to Sunday school, you couldn't go, you can't go with the toys, but back then you could.
Today you can't play with the toys upstairs, but back then you could. Well, I'm not sure if that's true or not. That all depends on the generosity of the Sunday school teachers this morning. Oh, she has got it! She has got it! The difference was, 18 months ago, two of you were normally asked on a Sunday morning if you would take up the collection just as we sang the second hymn, and then you'd bring out the front and I'd say a prayer. But what's different today? There it is. People gave in to the offering on the plate at the front door as they came in. We're still getting used to these things of reintroducing things like that. This morning was the first time that the deacons and persons leading worship have gone out to the lounge for a prayer before the service. So there should be a bit more of an improved service this morning, as I've been prayed for this morning. I've been prayed for the last 18 months. It's, you know, mediocre content. But that's another thing that we might have to get used to doing when we take the collection. Because what would happen if, say, Esme, you were asked to take the collection and people went round and they said, sorry, I haven't got any. Sorry, I haven't got any. Sorry, I haven't got any. Because you know what? For the last 18 months, I haven't had any money on me at all. Look here in my wallet. No money whatsoever. This was what, no, it's not what I'm saying, no. But this came home to me last week when we were on holiday together, and Debbie and I thought, oh, wouldn't it be nice to buy some pumpkins for our grandchildren so they could carve pumpkins? And we saw this wonderful display at a farm that we went past, and we went in and we said, we need like four of your most fabulous pumpkins, please. And he says, that would be £8 in cash.
Is it cash? Who has cash on them these days?
Hello, cash. Well, that was another thing. Another thing, we said, well, we need to upgrade our poppies. We've had these poppies for the last number of years. And Danny and I said, we must stop and buy a poppy this year. We stopped. And he said, cash only. That's what we're going to cash on us. And that's sometimes the difference in the world that we live in, isn't it? Things have changed, and not some of the things in the news the other week about how many different people are not carrying or getting cash out of cash machines these days, and what a difficulty it poses for those who still live virtually all their lives with cash in their pockets. Now, I was going to say that, of course, it would affect that reading that we just heard where Jesus sat and watched the people giving their offertory in the plague. But don't worry, Jesus isn't watching you this morning because you might not have cash on you. But Jesus still looks at our hearts and still looks at how we can give extravagantly to the world around us. And no matter what we do, we should do it from the offering of our hearts, because God has so freely given of his love to each one of us. So it's important to remember this lesson. The next time you come to church, we might ask later to take the offering or something like that, and things will be a bit more back to normal. But things have always been normal with our God, because his love is so extravagant and free for each one of us. He takes such pride in us because we are his children, his people. And so it is our pleasure to worship before God and to celebrate these wonderful things. Now, as I say, we're going to sing again. And during at the end of the singing of this hymn, the children will go up to their own lessons. So some of our leaders will take the children in the background, show them upstairs, so you'll be well looked after up there. You've got no help for this hymn that we're going to sing now, so it's a bit of a free-for-all. If I remember this right, Rick, what we usually do, I think the women sing the first verse on their own, and then the men come in singing the first verse, and the women go, you know what I mean, don't you? Yeah, oh, nods of recognition of how this goes, hopefully. And hopefully we'll all meet at the end in some sort of wonderful fashion. Hymn number 590. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thank you.
thanks before our next reading to our Sunday school leaders who prepared for this morning without knowing how many would be here. And they were very pleased to see so many here, and we thank them for their service this morning in being able to lead our children with their own activities upstairs. So we thank them for coming and sharing with us their gifts this morning. The second reading that I have to share with you this morning comes from the book of 1 Kings, chapter 17, reading verses 8 to 16. The common theme with our readings this morning is the story of widows, unnamed widows, and this is the very familiar story of the widow at Zarephath. Then the Lord said to Elijah, "Go and live in the village of Zarephath near the city of Sidon. I have instructed a widow there to feed you." So he went to Zarephath. As he arrived at the gate of the village, he saw a widow gathering sticks, and he asked her, "Would you please bring me a little water in a cup?" As she was going to get it, he called to her, "Bring me a bite of bread too, please," she asked. But she said, "I swear by the Lord your God that I don't have a single piece of bread in the house, and I only have a handful of flour left in the jar and a little cooking oil in the bottom of the jug. I was just gathering a few sticks to cook this last meal, and then my son and I will die." But Elijah said to her, "Don't be afraid. Go ahead and do just what you've said, but make a little bread for me first. Then use what's left to prepare a meal for yourself and your son. For this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. There will always be flour and olive left in your containers until the time when the Lord sends rain and the crops grow again." So she did as Elijah said, and she and Elijah and her family continued to eat for many days. There was always enough flour and olive oil left in the containers, just as the Lord had promised through Elijah. We're going to sing again. We've got two choruses to sing in our service this morning, the first of which is number 881, "Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad that you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us." Hymn number 881.
Just sing your praises. I'm so
in intercession for prayer today. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the beauty of your creation. Breathe into our hearts and our lives this day your stillness, your peace, and hear our prayers. Heavenly Father, this world we live in, this town we live in, the streets we live in, the houses we live in, may each be the focus of our prayers this day and this week. Heavenly Father, those that we live with, those we rub shoulders with, those we work with, those we don't get on with, may each be the focus of our prayer today and this week. Those who laugh, those who cry, those who hurt, those who hide. Heavenly Father, may each be the focus of our prayer today and this week. Prayers centered less on self and more on others. Less on our circumstances, more on the needs of others. Heavenly Father, may our life be likewise centered less on self and more on you. And through you to the world in which we live and move. And Heavenly Father, we are very mindful of the world around us, your creation. And as the United Nations Climate Conference, COP26, continues in Glasgow, we bring our prayers to God who created the earth and all within it. So we pray for world leaders, that they may all work together and through the decisions taken to try to protect the planet and all who live within it. We pray also for the Church, that together we may discern our roles and our tasks arising from decisions made, and may we take action to achieve them. And we pray for the world, that our collective actions will bring the long process of repair to the damage that we have caused, and that our God will help us to become better stewards. And we pray for our local community. The decisions taken in our communities will help us to live simply, sustainably, and in solidarity with the earth and all life within it. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers, for you call us all to be peoples to justice and care for the earth. Hear and grant these prayers, we ask, through Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. The second of those two choruses that I mentioned this morning is number 454 from Mission Praise. Majesty, worship His Majesty. Unto Jesus be glory, honour, and praise. Majesty, kingdom, authority flows from His throne unto His own, His anthem raise. Hymn number 454.
Thank you.
Sticking to the lectionary readings, those readings that are prescribed throughout the year as part of the cycle of our religious themes and faith, is sometimes one of those difficult things that you're not quite sure what's going to be in place the following week when you will have to prepare to the set readings that are given. And I'm glad that we have this exercise because it teaches us to look at the very different themes that the Bible instructs our lives with and helps me to plan the path I need to take, the route that we need to share together, the word that we want to hear from God in our lives. And my hope is that I'm inspired as I come to prepare, and that as you hear those readings from God's word, you too are similarly inspired and challenged by God. And I have to say that this week we came up with three wonderful readings to be inspired by. That wonderful psalm which talks about our partnership with God and yet making sure we put God first and lean only on his resources and his strength. And then that wonderful reading of God's provision of the widow at Zarephath, and that wonderful story of how Elijah told her to have hope, to believe and trust in God's providence for our lives. And that surely is a theme that many of us can sort of say is such an important thing for us all to learn and to have a part in our hearts and our lives. And hopefully that's an inspiring word for you all. And then the words of the Message version of the Bible as it translates Mark chapter 12 verse 44, she gave her all. This verse inspires us. It calls us to pause, to begin to reflect partly on our season of remembrance. Just as we've been inspired this morning as we walked through the magnificent display of poppies at the front of our church as we came into worship, which once again are drawing so many comments of appreciation from our local community. We will remember them. They gave their all. And next Sunday morning we shall especially remember and reflect on the names on our own plaque of remembrance in our church, as we give thanks to God for their service, their sacrifice, their all that they gave. Jesus called his disciples over and said, "The truth is that this poor widow gave more to the collection than all the others put together. All the others gave what they'll never miss. She gave extravagantly what she couldn't afford. She gave her all." I read those words in preparation for my service today. They truly did inspire me. But also, you also do get a little bit of a feeling of trepidation, of whether we can match up to that story as well. For this isn't just a reading about stewardship, but it's also about the very essence of our faith that we share, generosity. This is what kingdom life is all about, sharing something of the riches that we have been given, sharing something of the faith that we have been given, sharing something of the gifts that we have been given, and most importantly, sharing something of the love that we've been given. Generosity, such an important lesson to learn in our lives. And that is sometimes why I feel very envious of the widow who gave her all, don't you? Not just envious, but perhaps also some shame in some part, for she gave her all. How often do we hold back a little something? Or maybe even a big something sometimes. How often are our hearts not fully in it? How often is our service half-hearted? Or as the church at Laodicea discovered, how often is our service lukewarm? Where is that spirit of generosity? But let's not beat ourselves up too much here. Whilst a little bit of guilt is a healthy thing, it needs to lead us to response and to action. There is the opportunity for us to redeem ourselves, to be transformed, to give extravagantly of our lives. I hope my help and advice to those around me this week will be extravagant. I hope my pattern of living this week will be extravagant. I hope my worship and devotion of God this week will be extravagant. I hope my love in all things will be extravagant. After all, my inspiration comes not just from the widow who gave her all, but also from those 24 young men from Southwark Congregational Church who lived their lives extravagantly, who gave their all, and also from this unnamed woman in the Bible who gave extravagantly what she couldn't afford. She gave her all. And if there is one thing that I want you to remember from our service, from our time together this morning, it is that this story from Mark's Gospel reminds each one of us of how unique we each are. We have our own lives to lead, and we shouldn't compare ourselves to others. This isn't some sort of race that we're running where we need to see what position we will come in, although I was reminded of that when I ran the Oxford Half Marathon 3 weeks ago. I haven't seen you since then. I hope you weren't thinking that I hadn't recovered. I have managed to recover, and it was quite wonderful to be able to gather with my 10,000 other runners there to join with them in a celebration of running on that day. There was no expectation, at least I hope there wasn't, that all of us would run those 13 miles in just 70 minutes. We were all unique, we were all running our own race, and some of us were running very extravagantly and very funnily as well. I want to also thank you for your support, not just in your thoughts and prayers, but also for those of you who gave very generously to the cause that I was running for. I raised over £450 for Zoe's Place Baby and New Children's Hospice, and I thank you for that. And I was also very thankful for the advice given to me before the day, the advice that said, never do anything on race day that you haven't done in practice. So I'd worn the outfit I was running in on day before to make sure it all was okay. I'd taken the gels and the energy that you have to take during race to make sure it worked before race day. I'd taken in the fluids and all the rest that I had just to make sure that was enough for me on the day. I'd had that breakfast before that I knew would be able to give me the energy to run that day. What is amazing about this whole experience is there's always something that surprises you. And the one thing that I wasn't prepared for, I was prepared for the race and the running, the one thing that I wasn't prepared for was the crowd of runners that I was in and the crowds that lined the streets. I'm used to very much running around Draycott Water or the streets of Southern on my own, quite content with my headphones on and some music to get me running to a good pace. Sometimes people say hello to me or what on earth are you doing, that sort of thing, but that's about all the interaction I get. Well, on that morning 3 weeks ago when I lined up with all these runners, I wasn't quite prepared emotionally for the lift that this would give me. And all the other runners saying, you know, how excited they were and all the excitement about the beginning of the race and the hold before things actually started. But then actually running and seeing all the faces in the crowds who were supporting their family and friends as they took on this run. It was also a moment when it was more inspiring than I imagined it to be. I was at 3 miles when the first place person was at 12 miles going in the opposite direction. I did think at first that might sort of depress me a little bit. But as that happened, I was in a crowd at that time of around 200 people. All 200 runners started clapping and cheering this fellow who was coming in the opposite direction. And I suddenly realised that in many ways he was running the race for us and we were cheering him on because in each of us could see a little bit of us running that race. And it was quite emotional to have that. People talk about the wall and hitting the wall when you've got to the very end of the race and you feel like you can't go on any further. Just as I got to 12 miles, I suddenly had that feeling that, hello, the energy's beginning to run out here. But as I rounded the corner, I discovered that my family were sitting on the wall, and they were cheering me on. And that gave me such a lift that it was quite amazing that I expected the finish to be just round the corner from where they were. It was quite a way going to go after that, but it had given me the lift that I needed, and I was able to go on for those final few yards. What is amazing about our lives and our experiences is that when we approach the wall in our battle with illness, or in our struggle with economic squeezes, in the breakdown of relationships, and the lonely walk we sometimes have to take, in the midst of mental challenges of depression, anxiety, hopelessness, when we feel we're ready to just give it all up because the wall is too much to be taken on, we discover that God is sitting on the wall. He's the one who's still cheering us on and lifting us up. And remember what I said a moment ago, we are all unique. We are equally the people and children of God, but we are unique creations, masterpieces of God. I read a Twitter conversation this week that started by someone saying that the challenges of COVID-19 and the last 18 months had drawn them closer to God than they'd ever felt, and to a wonderful level of comfort and peace. And yet the first person that replied to that said that they too had never been closer to God than they were right now. And yet, their anxiety levels have risen steadily over the last 2 years. Our faith is not a one-size-fits-all solution. We are all unique individuals. We all react differently when we walk through the valley of the shadow of death. And God understands this. And He still responds to us extravagantly, urging us to live extravagantly. The other week on my run, I encountered 15,000 people cheering extravagantly and my family loving extravagantly. No matter how high or how low you feel today, look out for those extravagant people around you who deliver God's grace and God's goodness to us. And remember, when you can, live your life extravagantly too. Let us pray. Loving and ever-present God, we believe that your grace is sufficient for all things. Comfort us anew by your presence. Allow that in our weakness we may be made strong, in our grief consoled, and in our ignorance wise. Protect and guide us that we may know the way to take, and that each crossroad of life we may see the right path to choose. Safeguarded by your power, uphold us by your kindness, and warm us by your extravagant love. We ask this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. As we come to our final hymn this morning, I once again remind you that we will have coffee after our service this morning. You may go through to the lounge if you wish to, or you can stay in church. Someone will either ask you if you would like a drink and bring it to you, or you can go in there and bring it back into the church to sit and have a drink in here. So please do remain and share in fellowship with us all. But we sing our final hymn now, number 689. Thine be the glory, risen, conquering Son, endless is the victory, thou, O death, hast won. Hymn number 689.
Thank you. Lord.